This is Rebecca from chemistryismyjam.com. In this video, we're going to look at covalent bonding. Recall that atoms bond in order to gain full outer energy levels. The octet rule tells us that most atoms are satisfied with 8 electrons in their outermost energy level. Atoms can either transfer or share electrons in order to achieve full outer energy levels. In the case of covalent bonding, atoms will share electrons. Take fluorine, for example. Fluorine is a diatomic element, meaning that it is often found bonded with itself. Let's take a look at the type of bond that forms between two fluorine atoms. Each individual fluorine atom, before it bonds, has 7 valence electrons. Each one wants to have 8. If fluorine will come together with another fluorine atom and each one will share an electron with the other, they will each have 8 valence electrons, satisfying the octet rule and forming a covalent bond. In previous videos, we've looked at ionic bonding, where an electron has been transferred. That works well when you have a metal and a nonmetal. However, it does not work well in a case like fluorine, where you have 2 nonmetal atoms coming together. In the case where you have 2 nonmetal atoms coming together, a covalent bond will be formed where electrons are shared. The key to covalent bonding is that electrons are shared. Covalent bonds are formed between nonmetal atoms, which are mostly found on the right-hand side of the periodic table. In terms of physical properties, covalent compounds have low melting points and low boiling points. They tend to have poor electrical conductivity. Covalently bonded atoms form molecules or molecular compounds. These are individual, discrete units. What do I mean by them being individual discrete units? Let's compare formulas of covalent versus ionically bonded compounds to see the difference. Here, on the right, you have a water molecule, which is made up of covalent bonds. Water will always be 1 oxygen with 2 hydrogens. The chemical formula gives me the actual number of atoms present. In the case of an ionic compound, like sodium chloride, the Na and the Cl gives me the ratio of the atoms present. In an ionic compound, you have a series of positive and negative ions that are lining up to try to maximize the attractions between charged particles. So in the case of a molecule, the chemical formula is giving you the actual atoms present. In the case of an ionic compound, the chemical formula is giving you the ratio of the ions present. So these are a discrete individual unit, whereas these form a crystal structure. This is the flowchart that I introduced earlier in this series for how to name compounds. The first thing you want to ask yourself is there a metal present? For the case of covalently bonded compounds, the answer here is usually no. Typically, there is not a metal present for molecular compounds. They're made up of 2 nonmetals. So when you go to name those, you want to use prefixes in order to name your molecular compounds. Here you have the prefixes that are necessary to name molecular compounds. The prefixes for the numbers 1 through 10 are mono, di, tri, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, and deca. It would be a good idea to memorize those prefixes. Prefixes are added at the beginning of each element in the compound, and they tell you the number of each of those atoms present in the molecule. The molecule will need to end in IDE, just like in ionic compounds. The one rule to keep in mind is that mono can be omitted from the first element in the compound, but cannot be omitted from the second element in the compound. You will find that writing formulas for molecular compounds is simpler than ionic compounds because the charges do not matter. You simply go by the prefixes to determine the number of each element present. Let's look at some examples of how molecular compounds are named. We're going to be using the prefixes that we were just introduced to, and the prefixes are related to the subscripts. The prefix are going to indicate the number of each type of element present. In the case of N2O5, there are 2 nitrogens and 5 oxygens. The prefix for 2 is di, so we have dinitrogen. The prefix for 5 is penta, so it's pentoxide. The compound needs to end in IDE, and the prefixes tell me the number of each element present. In the case of carbon dioxide, there's 1 carbon and 2 oxygens. Remember the rule that mono can be omitted from the first element, but not from the second element. So I didn't need to write monocarbon here. It's just carbon. The first element does not have to have mono. So there's 1 carbon and then 2 oxygens, carbon dioxide. In this example, there's 1 of each, 1 carbon and 1 oxygen. I'm allowed to omit mono from the first element, but not from the second element. So I don't need mono here, but I do need it here, carbon monoxide. Notice that they all end in "-ide," and the prefixes tell us the number of each element present. Now that we've had a video introducing both ionic and molecular compounds, stay tuned for the next video where we will compare the two and use that flowchart to name a series of mixed compounds.